Is it better? No, I switched on some light. Is it okay like this?
Yeah, you're perfect. You're perfect. Because you also have all the brightness around you.
Yeah, I need it. I need colors to be alive.
Yeah. Do you know what? All the colors are around here in front of me. That's where I look at it. I actually thought of pushing the piece of furniture out of the way, so it was just a white wall and some plants.
It's very smart and professional about you.
That's the thing, you know, when you're when you're running workshops and so on, you got to think about your background in some way. Yeah, but hey, you know, here we are. I'm pretty sure we're live now, Thomas. I am so chuffed, and thank you so much for agreeing to come on this impromptu conversation with me Sunday morning. It's only 9 o'clock here where I am, so I've been up like really early to get. Just kidding.
So thank you for choosing me. I feel really flattered.
Oh, you're such an amazing person, and you know, I hadn't heard from you in a long time, because I've seen your post with your art and so on. I hadn't seen anything from you for a long time, so I thought it was kind of a nice time to get you in the spotlight.
you mean laughter wise you haven't seen a lot, or what?
No, your
art in general,
everything really. But I know that, you know, with Facebook algorithms it's changed and who you see regularly, yeah, and so on, but it was just, yeah, I thought, let's see what you're up to.
Yeah, I mean, actually it's amazing, because I looked where it all started, meeting you. This was in 2011 in Switzerland.
I know, it's a long time ago, isn't it?
And this was actually my second laughter teacher course, because I made it 3 times in a row, because I liked it so much, this international crowd. And Madan always asked me, what are you doing here again? And I said, I forgot everything. I have to refresh it. So this was actually a very enthusiastic start, let's put it that way.
Yeah, do you know, it's it was really interesting, because I knew that it wasn't your first time on the training, and you were so great at just connecting with everybody and connecting everybody together as well. Because when you come in a new group and you think, we're going to learn some laughter techniques and so on, yeah, but you don't know anybody necessarily and so on, and you've been through that experience before, and you just connected with everybody, and just this jolly giant from Austria.
Yeah, I still remember it as a really great time, and a lot of good things have happened since then. I mean,
yeah, did you do art when you did the training, or has that come afterwards, or?
Actually, I started in 1999. So before I started with laughter yoga, but what I decided after laughter yoga training, that I'll paint only when I'm in a good mood.
Wow, that makes sense.
Because I'm not this therapeutic painter who who reflects his own problems in his paintings, because I think there's enough shit on the wall. And I don't want people to pay for my problems that I put on canvas. So I see my paintings as, like, I call them petrol stations on the wall. You get some energy from it, whether it's conscious or subconscious, because colors are definitely energy. And I would like to influence or infect people to realize that they can get some support from the colors.
That's really amazing. You're absolutely right. I totally agree with you. It's energy and it's that vibration. I am actually wearing green today. But, you know, it's I really love what you're saying about it being the fuel for your energy and so on that you have on your walls. Because you're also right that, I mean, you must see this, because if you're as an artist, you probably look at other people's art as well, and more than maybe I would do.
Not so much, actually.
Oh, right. Okay. But what you're saying about people are putting the paint on the canvas and so on, and it is quite interesting, because if you put someone else's paint on your wall, how is that going to affect your own energy?
They're not thinking about it. In my point of view, people do it because, to most people, pain is much closer than joy. And that's why people are more sick than healthy, in my point of view.
Yeah.
Because it's a question where I put the focus.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
People want to understand their sickness rather than focus how to be healthy. I mean, there's nothing wrong with it, but it's a totally different approach where I put my energy to. And I always thought, I don't have to know why I've got this or that, because you get one answer and 10 more questions raise up. So I always focused on what's good, what's healthy, and what do I need right now? And some people say, oh, that's very selfish. And I say it's the totally opposite of it, because I take care of my so-called problems, and I'm not clinging to anybody or anything else to do it for me.
And do you know what? When you're healthy yourself, you can help others as well. Because if you're not healthy and you're clinging onto it, like you're saying, then there's no way you can help others, because you're so tied up in your own problems and challenges and so on, or whatever you just call it. But you were saying one thing as well. We were just talking before we went live, and you were saying one thing that really made me think, and it's such a true statement, that we're going through this time where health is really what everybody wants, and yet there's not many people who are like in the health services and so on. They're not promoting how to boost our immune system. They're just covering up the symptoms and so on, but where in fact we should help people, or they should help people, find ways of boosting their immune system, instead of then they get sick and then they just get some pills or medication or antibiotics or whatever, and it never disappears, instead of finding a way of really getting healthy. Just like you're saying, with deal with your things and find a way to boost your immune system. And then things will be so much better, because you can so much easier avoid it, can't you?
Absolutely. I wonder if people have got a good voice or a strong voice in public who promote get your immune system on track so you're more healthy, more independent, and actually more free.
Yeah.
But to me, it's like this free energy that has been suppressed by companies, because it's free.
Yeah.
And that's the same with laughter. And to me, laughter has still got a bad reputation. Let's call it that way. People say, okay, it's fun, but that's just the whipped cream on the cake. The most important is it's healthy, and people have still not understood completely how healthy laughing is. Everybody knows the saying, laughing is the best medicine, but they don't really understand what's behind it.
No, but that's because people are still relying on other people and situations mm-hmm. to make them laugh. Mm-hmm. And even, you know, even people who come and train and, you know, I love when people come and train, because it's an investment in themselves and in other people as well, because they're going to go out and change the world around them. Yeah. But often what happens is that then, you know, the daily practice doesn't really happen. And this is where the change happens.
Mm-hmm.
And this is where you become healthier. And, you know, it's, we talk about it when we talk about laughter yoga, then it's not enough to do the social laughter, especially not right now, where we don't necessarily come out and meet in the same way as we used to.
Yeah.
Yeah, so...
I mean, it's, to me, the crisis, if I call it like that, it's like a big magnifying glass. So whatever there is bigger, stronger, better or worse. I mean, there's both sides, and there's a big chance for everybody to grow and to be. But like you said before, mankind doesn't really like changes. We somehow want change, but we're not changing anything, so change doesn't come.
Yeah.
And maybe some even don't know where they want to change.
Yeah, and maybe that's where the fear is, that you want change, but you don't quite know what it's going to look like. And then when different solutions are being presented, it's not exactly what I had in mind, but they don't really know exactly what they had in mind. So that's where it's easy to say, no, I don't want that. And then we stay the same. But, you know, change happens no matter what. And we can see it on our bodies when we're growing older.
Yeah, sure. I remember a guy who was really a smart guy. And he said, you can fight nature or you can fight change. You're only losing 100%.
Absolutely. Yeah.
It costs so much energy to fight change. And this is what I see by myself and also with others. Sometimes we stick to things which don't make sense at all.
But it's staying in that safety box, isn't it? You know, we're staying within the space. We know what it is. Even if we don't necessarily like it, we still know it. Yeah.
Yeah, but I also think it takes time and you have to be patient enough.
Oh, gosh, yeah.
It reminds me when a big ship comes to the harbor, it has to put the back gear in quite some distance beforehand to actually stop. And this is how I see it with the old habits, you know? Even if we go the other way, it's still pushing us in the direction where we know it's not the direction we want to go,
yeah. But
it's still pushing us there. So it takes time and energy to change things if it's important for us. I mean, we are usually far away from surviving. So maybe we're kind of lazy and...
Yeah, not, maybe that's the...
and not taking it serious enough. I mean, I don't know.
No, but you know what? A lot of people see that or find that if you want change, it's too much hard work because then you have to create new habits and it doesn't happen overnight. This is why, you know, years ago there were so many, and there are probably still lots of these being promoted, but I remember seeing all these quick fix solutions like multi-level marketing companies pushing out their products. And you could get rich quick. But it doesn't work that way because you still have to put in all the work to build it up and so on. And it's a little bit the same with our health and well-being, that we got to take some little steps every day. And if all we do is swim against the stream, it's just going to be hard work, isn't it? Instead of going with the flow, it's like the what you were saying before, it's we're fighting it and it's just going to be hard work. So instead just going with the flow
and taking
our little steps every day, I think is so important.
It's like a shortcut mentality.
Yeah.
I mean,
what you were saying about people being lazy, I'm not pointing fingers. It's, you know, all of
you. No. You know, I had so much routine and discipline in my professional life. And now I'm retired. Da, 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 da,
da, da. You're not old enough to be retired.
I got the people to guess how old I am, and then I said, okay, I'm retired. No, but really, I know if I have to, I can be extremely disciplined. And it's also... I know I'm responsible for my life and what I do, and what I don't do, I take responsibility for it.
Yeah.
And if I talk with people in my age group, let's call it that way, they're somehow tired also of discipline, because they said, I had to be disciplined all my life. I want to live now. Like the kids with 15, 20 years, they want to live also, but they haven't lived disciplined yet. And I'm sure it will, I mean, it's a big challenge for the younger generation to bring the changes, but I think it's also unfair to say, yeah, the old ones have screwed it up and now we have the burden, because they also are having the benefits that the old ones have achieved. So you can't see it only from one side.
Oh, I totally agree, because the generations that are set to have screwed it up, like you're saying, they were the ones who tried to create change that at that time, because we felt that the older generation had maybe messed up some things as well. So it's just, it happens in every generation, doesn't it? And of course, the thing that the generations are set to have been messing up is, of course, the climate, the environment, and so on. But we have all been benefiting from all the things that have created this situation.
Yeah.
And I'm keen to really promote environmental awareness and creating the changes we need, each of us, but we need to do it ourselves, don't we? Because it starts with that one person first, just like you were saying. You look after yourself first, and then you can look after other people. It's like they say when you're flying out somewhere, and they say, in case of oxygen, then put your own mask first, and then help others, yeah?
But I think it's a religious thing, because the church tells you, I don't know the English word, Märtyrer, the ones who put the others first before me.
Okay. Say the word again.
Märtyrer, the ones who give everything from themselves to others. And this is just sick. I mean, if I say love the other one like yourself, then I'm hating myself if I give everything away to others.
Yeah.
Because then I'm needy. And this is what I realized in life and also in relations. People cannot be by themselves. They would rather have a bad relation than being alone with themselves, because they are not investing time to get to know themselves, what they actually want with their life. And this question gets bigger and bigger the older you get. But people are afraid of being alone, and this starts very young.
You're so right. And, you know, that whole connection with the self is like daunting. One of the exercises I sometimes tell people to practice when they start practicing laughter every day is spend time with themselves in the mirror, because then they're laughing with someone, but not just looking at laughing and ha 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 ha, but really, before they start laughing, connect with themselves, spend like 30 seconds. Sounds like not a lot, but it is a lot if you're not used to it. Just looking into your own eyes and connecting with your own self. Mm-hmm. And for many people, it's like, oh, I can't do that. Where it is where you create the first connection with yourself. And then, you know, as you go on, you increase the time and so on. Mm-hmm. So you do it every day. And at the end of the, when you really have connected with yourself, that's where self-care becomes, you know, self-care is quite a buzzword as well, isn't it? But it is what it is, and we should look after ourselves in order to actually be able to help where it's needed.
Yeah, I always tell people, be your best friend. And if you want to be that, you have to spend time with yourself. But I think some people are scared that they might not be as good as they appear in public, because we've got everything in us. We are not only the nice guys and the shiny guys. We've also got the other side. And I realized many people don't want to see that. I mean,
but it's acknowledging it and staying with it.
Yeah. And saying, okay.
Yeah. Sorry.
No, okay. I'm still practicing. I'm human.
We are, so, aren't we? It is a human experience.
Be kind to yourself. This is I'm also teaching drumming, djembe drumming.
Oh, fantastic. And I should come to your classes then.
And funnily enough, I have three couples in my class. And it's like couple therapy. I mean,
yeah.
I always tell them funnily, you don't have to pay extra for the therapy. It goes with the rhythms. And so everything we do is kind of therapeutic.
Yeah.
But the good thing is, in laughter, we don't call it like that.
Yeah.
Because some people, they're closing when they hear the word therapy. Yeah. They say, oh, am I wrong or what is it? Yeah. But I realized over the years that laughter is one of the most intimate things you can do with people. And this is why some are really scared of doing it, because you cannot hide when you're laughing.
No
control, you're just yourself, and people are scared of showing how they really are.
But this is the problem sometimes, I feel, well, I wouldn't call it a problem, but this is where people are really holding back. So they avoid showing their true self. And, you know, it's one of the things, you know, with holding back is that it's sometimes because of the fear of other people's opinion about you. And going into that whole conversation about thinking too much about what other people think, instead of just looking after the self first, just like we've been talking about. And that's where people are holding back and not really connecting in that way, like you're saying, because I absolutely agree with you that laughter is one of the most profound connections we make, and really intimate. And if you think about all the chemicals, including oxytocin being released, this is a love hormone. So of course it's really, really deep and so connecting on an emotional level too. So it's just what's holding us back is what we've been told all our life.
And plus we've got also the critic in us that talks.
Yeah, but that is, in my opinion, often based on what we've grown up hearing and other people's opinions.
It's conditioning. I mean,
yeah.
Sometimes they say, if everything we know got just erased and we start totally fresh, would it be an advantage or not? This is my kind of mind games I sometimes do.
Yeah.
Because the older you get, the more you realize how many patterns you've got that are not from yourself, but like you said, and I totally agree with that, that we've been told so many times that we think, okay, it is like that. Yeah. But I think getting older is questioning everything we heard before, everything.
Yeah.
And see if it's right for us, then keep it. And if it's not, try to drop it.
Yeah, I think you're right about that. But again, you know, it's getting you to a place where you are comfortable and you don't have the fear of, let's call it retaliation. Because it is, again, when you try and snap out of it or step out of that whole box or bubble you've been in where other people's opinions have been playing a big role in your life, then the opinions are going to come at you even stronger. And that's where it really tests your resilience to pull through with, well, actually, I want to step out of it.
And you might lose some good friends. Huh?
Exactly, yeah, exactly.
But I think it's worth, because, I mean, friendship is such a fragile thing. And
yeah.
I realized in my life, my opinion what friendship is totally different than it was before.
Yeah.
And the number has decreased, of course. But it's also because I'm not needing it anymore so strongly.
Yeah.
Sure, it's nice to have people around, but usually it's a improvement of how you are and what you are.
I think to some extent I agree with you, but I think the people who then stick around are the ones who in some way are on that wavelength as well, where It's not about you always sitting on each other's laps and rah, rah, rah. But it's about knowing that, that's where you say friendships are so fragile. I actually think if it's real friendships, they're really strong. No matter how often you speak, how often you're together and so on, they're there. And it's because there is a different connection than just opinions about each other. You've been maybe through things, you've cleared out differences, you've had discussions, you've had arguments, you've been through all that, and that's what makes it strong. And yes, some people will not tolerate that, you know, you step out and say, well, actually, I disagree. I was, for many, many years, this is way before I moved to England, way before laughter and so on, I was such a nice person, agreeing with everybody and just doing a lot of things where it was extra work and so on. So when I left a job, for example, and someone else I knew would take over the job, they always had a lighthearted go at me for leaving them with expectations from people that they would do the same as I would. So, you know, a real, yes, I'll do it. And being nice and not having an opinion as such. I remember one person said to me once, I don't know who you are because you don't have any opinions. And my reply was, well, I've got the same opinions as you do.
But isn't it also a dialogue in Pretty Woman where he asked her how she would like her breakfast eggs?
Oh, gosh, I forgot about that.
And she said, I want it like you want it. And he said, yeah, that's your problem. You still don't know how you would like your eggs in the morning.
Is that in Pretty Woman?
I think it's Pretty Woman.
Oh, I don't remember that at all.
If not, it's from a movie, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah.
But anyway, coming back to friendship, I mean, sure, it should be supportive to both ways, or else it will not work.
Yeah.
But what I find funny in friendships is, I mean, I don't know how to translate it. Let me think for a second.
If you sometimes say it in German, I may be able to understand it.
I try to put it in English. Sometimes you put a problem or a burden on a friend that you would never put on a stranger.
Yeah.
So sometimes I feel it's a disadvantage as a friend, because people expect more of you than from a stranger. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, but isn't that what friendship is about as well?
I mean, sometimes if it's too hard to digest, I would rather choose to be a stranger. And it's not, I don't mean it cynical. I really mean it like I say it.
Yeah.
And luckily enough, I've got some really good friends, and they are also old friends, because like you said, it needs to grow like a tree.
Yeah.
And I also realized sometimes you think this is friendship, but you only know each other for a long time. And that's also two different pairs of shoes.
That is true. But with the friendships, I feel that is where you can come and you can tell these things that the other person may feel like, gosh, that's very tough to actually digest. But it's okay as well, because sometimes all you need is that friend who listens and who knows that you will listen to them as well if they come to you. And you don't always have to offer an advice or say anything. You're just there as an ear and a heart.
If I think of it, I'm asking before, do you want an advice or do you want just to listen? Because I'm the one who's always thinking of solutions.
Yeah.
So if somebody comes to me and tells me things, my head is spinning of solutions. But like you said, sometimes it's more than enough to just listen with an open heart that the other feels, okay, I'm not alone.
Yeah. But that's what friendship is about. And friends are also the ones you can tell your honest opinion, and they may get upset by it first and angry with you, but you know that you can clear the air afterwards. And nothing's ever that harshly said, I feel, but it is sometimes we need to also be there as someone who opens other people's eyes if that's what needed. Because it is, I do feel that often we are clouded by so many opinions, and other people will always have opinions. No matter what, we all have thoughts, don't we? We all have opinions, and there's nothing we can do about it.
No, it's related to our life that we've lived so far.
Yeah.
I mean, everybody sees it from its own perspectives and the experience we've already made. Yeah. There is no fresh opinion.
No, absolutely.
it's all a result of what has happened to us before.
And but this is why it's someone else's opinion. And you know, with that, we give advice based on, and we offer our opinion based on our own experience. But it's never, ever fully going to apply to someone else because their life is different and their experience is different.
And that's the funny part about being a parent.
Oh gosh.
I'm living with my daughter now for 3 years.
Yeah.
She's 19 years old. And there's many times when I'm thinking, oh, I should have saved my oxygen for something else. Because I don't know what's going on in her life. I mean, even if she tells me, some things I can relate to, but some things are just like talking in another language to me.
That is so funny. Maybe it's because I do share a place with my daughter. She's 25, yeah, and you know, I can relate to a lot of what she's going through and so on. And of course there are lots of things, just like you, where I think, why is this and why is that? I can still kind of see it from her perspective. I don't know if it's the difference between being a mom and a dad.
Maybe.
Or it's simply, I don't know.
But the microphone
I've lived with my daughter her whole life, so maybe okay. That makes a difference as well.
Your picture is stuck.
I know. My internet says unstable. So you're boosted it because
Lotte, if your internet says you're stable, then you're stable.
Unstable. Stable. So do you laugh with your daughter?
Sorry?
Do you laugh with your daughter a lot?
I mean, I laugh with her. But not like laughter yoga.
No.
Yeah, I mean, we've got a lot of fun, but I can tell you a nice story. It was some years ago when I did Skype laughter for quite some time. And the first time she saw me doing laughter yoga via Skype, she looked at me seriously and said, "Daddy, you scare me." And I thought, yeah, that's the program, that laughter is really dangerous because many people are interpreting as less respect or revolution or not taking anything serious.
Yeah, and you know what? This comes back to what we talked about in the beginning, because it's about shifting that to being one thing where people see it as, well, actually, it's good for our health. And it's strengthening our ability to fight off illnesses and so on. It may not mean that we don't catch them, but maybe we're stronger in recovering from them and so on. And that's why it's just a shift in how people see laughter. And it takes a really, really long time, doesn't it? You think about it, we've been doing this for such a long time.
I mean, it depends how we compare it with the time that has already been before.
Yeah.
To the time where it is now. I think it's still very little to the program that has been on maybe since mankind.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the effect of laughter has been used, or laughter has been used throughout time, hasn't it? You know, if you, one of the things I remember hearing on the news once or on some program was that, you know, the early people and the apes that are closest related to us and so on used laughter as a social tool, because you connect in with a group, and if you want to be part of a group, you don't come in with a harsh voice or so, because then you're out again. Yeah, but you come in with a little can I be part of your gang? And that was how the groups kind of evolved, with the laughter and so on. And I think it's just interesting that that was the, and then later on, of course, we found out, well, this is quite good for our health, but that's much, much later. That's like probably millions of years later.
I mean, what comes to my mind right now is thinking of Jim Carrey and Robin Williams, two of the most funniest people on this planet.
Fighting. It depends on who you are, whether you see them as funny. I love them.
I mean, both of them, I've seen almost all the movies, and I got old shows from Robin Williams, stand-up comedian, and on the other hand, you know that those people are fighting depression for such a long time, and even killed themselves. So maybe this is also the other side, like the sad clown in the circus. Yeah. I mean, I don't know. How do you feel about it?
I think you're right. There are, you know, but this is where what we're doing is has a different grip, because with comedy and so on, you often hear that people are hiding behind the comedy, and, you know, people who are comedians are so busy making other people laugh that they forget about themselves. It was said, I read somewhere, it was said that Groucho Marx, for example, if you remember him, are you old enough to remember?
oh, Granny, tell me about Groucho. was he the one with the mustache?
It was said that he was never seen to laugh in his private life. He was so busy making people laugh on screen and so on in the movies. The Marx Brothers, he was the one with the hat and the suit and the.
Is it because it's intellectual?
Yeah, that is.
I mean, comedy, if it's not slapstick, like.
Well, Marx Brothers was a little bit slapstick.
Yeah, it was both actually. Yeah.
But you still have to with comedy. You still have to get the punchline or whatever it is with your intellect, and that's the whole thing, isn't it? And with slapstick, where it's like people falling and so on, it's that the reaction with laughter is the initial response is and then you laugh because it releases that response that you had, that shock first, and then it releases it with laughter. Yeah, but with more clever like Jim Carrey and Robin Williams, like you're saying, it is your intellect as well that's in full motion there, isn't it? And it doesn't mean that it's not about your intelligence. It's just whether you grasp the joke and whether it's for you. And that's why I was saying Jim Carrey and Robin Williams, maybe not everybody likes them. Maybe some.
No, sure not. I mean.
And that's where comedy and humor is so selective, isn't it? Where what we do with laughter yoga and laughter and just laughing together that's the way forward, because that's for everybody, isn't it? If you think about it.
I mean, it's really a thing by itself, because in Austria, for example, the red nose clowns are very popular.
Yeah.
they are in hospitals, and I think they do an extremely good job, and they have good marketing and everything. But it's a big difference to laughter yoga.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And people, sometimes they don't know what's the difference. And I say it's a big difference because the red mouse clones, blah, 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 red mouse clones, they make people laugh, which is great.
But we don't make people laugh. We help people find their own source of laughter.
Right.
An activity where you just...
But in public, I mean, everybody in Austria knows the red nose clowns. Everybody. Yeah.
The red nose is a symbol, isn't it? And it's a symbol of kindness and that connection, isn't it? Because we know that the red nose clown is, you know, a friend. Yeah. Which is different from, do you remember a couple of years ago when those scary clowns came out? What was that even all about? Again, scaring people, eh?
But I remember I was once invited to a symposium of the red nose clowns.
Uh-huh.
And it wasn't funny at all, anyway. They were discussing, I don't know, 10 minutes where the humor sits in the brain. And I was thinking, it's the same coming back to art. Yeah. Art has become so intellectual, and to me, it's the totally opposite.
Yeah.
It's got nothing to do, but it's with the galleries and everything. You have the feeling you have to be a doctor to understand art. And I say, it's not about understanding art, it's about feeling it and being touched by art.
I completely agree with you. And for me, it's the same with laughter, that it's not about intellectualizing it and so on. And yeah, you know, we like, most people like some sort of comedy and so on, but we cannot wait for those moments to happen all the time. That's why it's so, so important that we can find that source of laughter in ourselves. But I do think that, you know, a lot of people do say, oh, I have enough laughter. I laugh a lot in my life. And yet it turns out, actually, it's on account of someone else. You know, that's the other thing with comedy and humor and so on, that is often it's someone else who's tripping up or is making fun of someone else. Some stand-up comedians I've been watching and so on once, because I don't like when it's making fun of someone else. Don't mind when it's the comedy that's reflecting on yourself, because that's where you can kind of see yourself in that as well. But when people are pointing fingers, that's when it becomes hurtful.
But maybe we are taking ourselves too serious.
Maybe.
Because this is what I realized. I was invited to give a talk to MS people, multiple sclerosis.
Yeah.
And I could hardly talk because I was so nervous, because I was thinking beforehand, what can I really give them where they've gone through so much pain and whatever. So yeah. So I was really wrecking my head. What do I tell? I had like 50, 60 people, most of them in wheelchairs or really handicapped already.
Yeah.
And I said, look, I can hardly talk, because I was just honest and said, because I'm so nervous, because what can I give you? And then I realized it was the connection. I went to the first person, shook his hand, and was laughing with the person and had eye contact. And I could feel it was a shift in the energy in that moment. But beforehand, I wanted to reach them with my knowledge, what I know about the effects and blah, 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 blah. And they've heard all that many times before. But the moment when they realized that they can actively do something for it, this made the shift. I don't know if anybody changed anything in their life, but for me, it was the freedom. I'm not responsible for it.
Yeah.
And it was really like a big burden on my shoulders. I can still feel it, and it's more than 1 year ago.
I love that. I love that where you say that it was a burden off your shoulders. But I think the minute we step out of our heads, because you're absolutely right, what we have in here, people can read in a book or they may already have heard it. But when we come from here, and this is what I teach as well, that when you got to know your stuff, because when you know your stuff, you can connect it in with your own heart and so on. You can pick the little bits and pieces that really connect in. And when you're sharing a little bit in a group, then it has to come from here, because the other stuff is just pages in a book, you know? Sometimes then we come up with a little, and then we go back to, okay, what was it I was going to say? And I remember I did that way, way back, you know, when I first started doing this, what was it, 18 years ago and so on. I was really focused on that whole thing, remembering it, so on. And, you know, it took me years until I realized, well, actually, I just need to do it slightly different. But it's so rewarding when you see that change in people. And, you know, I don't know if you know, but my story with MS was, that was the reason I started the telephone laughter.
Yeah, I read your story.
Started laughing every day, because before that I didn't laugh every day, but it made a huge difference. And I'm never saying that it may reverse anything at all, whether it's MS or something else. But, you know, if we can change our perspective a little bit and just let go of some of that seriousness.
And maybe before
facing these serious challenges.
And maybe before the pressure gets too strong.
Exactly, yeah.
Sometimes the pressure has to be big enough until we are ready to change things.
But maybe that's why it's, you know, when you get older, that's when you're ready for it, instead of when you're young.
Sure.
I wouldn't have recognized laughter yoga when I was 20 or so, because I was not ready for it, you know?
and this is also why usually the laughter yoga groups are 40 and up.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, they're also youngsters.
Yeah, absolutely.
But usually they don't stay with it because they think, oh, we've got enough fun with our friends. And
it's different kind of fun as well. It's different kind of laughter with friends. And yet there are exceptions. You can't generalize. But, you know, when we generalize, I completely agree. You know, it is often late 30s as the earliest, and then up to what, 60s or so, yeah?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I've been in schools for quite some time with laughter yoga.
Oh,
with
fantastic.
Teenagers. That was a good lesson for me. But it was nice, because I said I only do it if the teacher is also with us.
Yeah.
So the kids and the teacher got to know each other in a different way.
Yeah. Like this. I said, say that too in schools, that the teacher, if they're in the room, they has to be. Join in.
And I remember in one class, everything was fixed. The tables and the chairs were screwed to the floor. And I said, who did this, McDonald's, or what are you doing here? I mean, there was no way to move the furniture. So we were running around the tables and sitting on it. It was just crazy.
Oh, funny. That is funny. Yeah. But this is the thing, you know, you learn to improvise as well when you're in so many different settings and so on with laughter yoga.
And I remember one day I was booked from a group. They were teenagers and up. And this was like almost the last station where people were working with them.
Ah, okay. Yeah.
So, and I was booked for a whole day, and I thought, wow, this could be interesting. And I had a friend with me, and she's a great laugher. And I knew this is perfect, because they told me it's male and female. So I thought it will also be good if there are women or girls there.
It's nice if it's a full day. It's actually nice to go in there with someone else, because it's not just your energy, not that it's, but you get someone to bounce off as well. And, you know, do different things and do different things in different ways. I think it's a great idea.
Yeah, but it was really, I mean, I remember it felt like 10 days, everybody was standing in a corner, not even looking at you. And stuff. And I had the idea beforehand, I've got a huge drum where 8 people can drum at the same time.
Wow, yeah.
Like a powwow drum, and I had it with me.
Yeah.
So I had them drum, and it was really, some of them were drumming like, this is the end of you, guy. So, and the woman who was the leader of this group, who was the grown-up, I knew she couldn't really relate to what I'm doing. And after we really powered our energy and also the aggression of the bodies, I said, okay, if anybody's ready for it, we can hold hands. And the guy to the left, he rejected. He said, I don't want to do that. I said, okay, cool. And the woman who was leading it, she said to my right, and I gave her my hand, and I took her hand, or she gave, I don't know, whatever. And she said, what are you doing? And I said, you're not even realizing what I'm doing. So it was difficult to come through to her,
yeah,
because she has done one day shooting bow and arrow, one day doing this, one day doing that. And she said, yeah, nothing really worked. And I said, maybe you should do things more often to really see the effect,
yeah,
and not just trying it one time. And then if we should stick with the partner where we have the first experience, usually we would not do it.
Yeah.
Because first times are really stressful for everybody.
Yeah.
And so it for me, it was kind of disappointing because I could see some of them were really opening up. There was a guy, for example, he was tattooed all over. He came later, you know, with a hoodie.
Yeah.
He was like from 50 Cent movie, you know, like, oh, I just got out of jail after 25 years. And he was observing me like, I can see what you're doing. He was not talking at all. And at the end of the session, he gave me the biggest compliment ever. He said, in the beginning, I didn't believe you at all, but now I see that you're living it. And this was so great for me because
that is so touching.
Because I accepted him as he was, although he looked really scary. I mean, I'm 2 meters tall, so I'm not a scary guy at all. But he looked at me and said, yeah, I better not mess up with him because I'll be on the safe side.
But you know what? This is one of the key lessons as well, you know, that never judge anybody because you never know what people take away. Even if they don't come to you and tell it, you don't know what they take away from,
yeah,
from whatever it is we're doing with them. I was going to ask you, I think it's really moving what you're saying as well, because it's so easy to look at people and say, oh, they're going to be responding that way and they're going to do this and they're going to. But it's coming with an open mind and non-judgment always, yeah, I think. So, yeah, fantastic. So do you ever incorporate, I was going to, because I keep getting my vision dragged to your art in the background as well. Not that I don't want to look at you. But I keep thinking, have you ever incorporated like painting and so on into laughter sessions?
Yeah, I did it when I was in India. I did it with Martin in 2014. We were in schools and we separated the groups in one just painting and the other's first laughter. You went painting and then looked at the paintings, and it was amazing to see the difference, how much more playful the ones were from the group who had laughter before. And I was leading with a female laughter club. There were only ladies. This was amazing. And I mean, the energy was there like being in a shrine. You know, there were like 20 women, and because it was Indian organized, we were painting with fingers on, I don't know, paper that we tore apart because there was not enough fiber. But they were so happy and so beautiful. And I did it when I was in Japan.
Yeah.
I had a workshop in Japan where I did laughter yoga, and after that we did painting with the group. And this is amazing because, like I said before, it's emotional and not intellectual. And I also give seminars with my friend in Austria, where we're painting with people blindfolded.
Wow.
So we have like a short meditation before, and then they just pick the colors blind and they're painting blind, just to get this thinking brain, or giving the thinking brain no chance to interfere. And this is amazing because this is how I learned how to paint without any imagination what's the coming out of it. And so I could
develop. I think that's where art is coming from. It is coming from that deep space that we don't even know how extensive it is. It reminds me a little bit of, because I love what you're saying, that you're using it in these different settings and so on. You know, have you heard of healing headbands in the US? They work with cancer patients and who have gone through maybe losing their hair and so on. So you have, you know this, with the cold and so on. Yeah.
Yeah.
So what they do is they run a laughter session, and then they the participants, they paint afterwards, just like you were talking about. Yeah. And this, what they paint, is the facilitators take away, and they have it printed onto this material as headbands, and then the person who painted it gets their art back on a beautiful headband they can wear. And I think it's just so beautiful.
I would not print it, I would paint directly on the canvas.
Well, it's kind of like a flimsy material, so you can't really do it, and the way it's...
Oh, I see.
It's done that way. But it's really special, and you go beautiful away with something that's so, it's coming from your heart, isn't it? You know, it's coming
and
from
it's
your creative
self. It's empowering. It's like an anchor. This is what I tell the people. You're painting an anchor. So anytime you look at it, you're in that space, and it gives you that energy.
Yeah.
And this is what I like about it. When people do something for themselves and realize they are capable to do things, new things,
yeah,
if they're not judging it before they have done it.
Mm.
Because this is what happens many times. You say, I cannot paint, I cannot drum, I cannot sing, whatever. But usually...
You know what? I can't do many of those things either, but I do it anyway.
I mean, I read a book once that said, feel the fear and do it anyway.
Yeah, exactly.
And that's basically what is life about it. Everybody has got fear, but the difference is in the people who've got fear and still do it, and people who are just paralyzed by fear, but they're not living the life to the fullest if anybody on this planet does this.
No, and this is the thing, isn't it? The fear is keeping us either in the past or in our future, thinking of what's going to happen that may never, ever happen. So we don't really stay present to people or to life itself, because we're so busy worrying and being fearful. I can't believe, Thomas, it's almost been an hour we've been talking. Is there any final words you want to leave people with, like something... Really, really deep. Well, you are deep, so I really, really appreciate this conversation.
I'm seeing really deep.
Yeah, never take yourself too serious.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, look in the mirror, then you know.
That's the thing, isn't it?
Yeah, Lotte, I really enjoyed talking with you. And like you said, 1 hour is gone like this.
Yeah. Yeah, I could talk forever, but you know, I know it's Sunday. Have you had breakfast yet, though? Are you going to wake up your 19-year-old girl?
Maybe we're talking privately next time.
Yeah. There's so much, and it's really nice to reconnect with you as well.
I mean, it would.
Well, we met in Frankfurt again, didn't we? Mm.
We met in Frankfurt, which was a big shift in my relation to laughter yoga, I have to say.
Oh, was it?
Not going into details. Yeah, it made
we
it.
Can talk about that privately, yeah.
Yeah. Sure. I mean,
yeah.
Like you said, things change and yeah.
Yeah, it does. But like you say, really about not taking yourself too seriously, no matter what changes we're facing it.
No. I mean, it doesn't bring us any further.
No.
If we get rewarded by taking things serious, then it would make sense. But actually, it doesn't make sense at all. No. maybe we'll see not so long like it was last time.
I know. Yeah, let's check. Yeah, that too. Yeah.
To
get past this situation and hopefully we'll meet in person from around the world again at some point. And yeah, I love Austria anyway, so I'll come and hello, knock on your door. Hi, Thomas.
And we'll see. I mean, if this whole madness comes to an end one way or the other,
yeah,
because closed borders is the last we need.
We need to, the energy is changing, it's shifting, and I think, you know, people are not going to put up with it for too long.
Yeah.
So, yeah, on that note, have a really lovely Sunday. And
you too?
Yeah, remove that serious face now.
I'm myself getting serious quite often.
Yeah, well, you know what? It's what a philosopher does, isn't it? You think about things, you reflect, and then you smile a little bit, maybe.
There's a slight chance for it.
But you know what? As long as it's inside, that's brilliant.
I mean, it's definitely inside and it's got a big face. And
your art shows it, so get painting again soon. Take care for now, yeah?
You too.
Lots of love.
Bye-bye.